Now, this Friday, as we head to the polling booths to choose our next president, we'll also be deciding on whether or not to remove the clause on blasphemy in the Constitution. Now, we heard yesterday from the Vote No side, so it's time to turn our attention to those advocating a yes vote. And to do that, I'm joined by John Hamill from Atheist Ireland. John, good morning to you.
Good morning, Fran. How are you keeping?
I'm very well indeed. Good to talk to you, John. You've been lobbying for this for about 10 years or so, haven't you?
That's right, and I think it's been an issue for the Irish state for around that time as well. I mean, I think that the most powerful reason to ensure that Ireland votes yes relates to our international obligations over that time frame, and that's not kind of some, you know, abstract or theoretical argument. I can suggest for your listeners that they might imagine that they were part of a real Irish delegation that represented this state at the 13th session of the United Nations Human Rights Council, which lasted from the 9th to the 30th of October in 2009. And the purpose of that session was for the nations of the world to try and find agreement on how to combat discrimination against minorities, including religious minorities. And they discussed the blasphemy laws in countries like Pakistan, where at that time a Christian lady called Asia Bibi had been arrested for blasphemy, and Asia Bibi remains on death row today, waiting to be executed for insulting the Prophet Muhammad. Now, when Pakistan was challenged to stop executing religious minorities for blasphemy, they responded to the United Nations by proposing the verbatim language from the then recently passed Irish blasphemy law, and they wanted the language from our blasphemy law inserted into international law. So just put yourself in that meeting as part of the Irish delegation. What on earth are you to do? You're trying to save people from being executed for blasphemy, and the people doing it are proposing the very legislation that had just passed through our Dáil.
But surely we can't help it, John, if somebody wants to use a piece of our legislation in some sort of distorted fashion. Surely we can't help that, can we?
Well, firstly, they're not using it in a distorted fashion. They're using the absolute verbatim language from our legislation, and we certainly can help the people who are the victims of those laws, because when we launched our campaign, we provided an open letter from 23 people around the world who are the victims of those laws. And what they've said is when they try to reform the laws in their countries, what's often cited back to them is that these kind of discussions at the United Nations, where Western countries like Ireland introduce our blasphemy laws. So what they have done is to ask Ireland to remove our blasphemy law as part of their campaign to help put pressure on their countries. So I don't think we should turn our backs on people like Asia Bibi, the Christian lady who's waiting to be executed for blasphemy. I don't think we should ignore those pleas. And when our law is being cited at the United Nations to help to support the execution of Asia Bibi, when Pakistan is citing Ireland as best practice in blasphemy law, that's a good indication that we're doing something wrong.
What about with our own country, if the argument is there that by holding on to blasphemy in the Constitution, that at least it protects some sort of respectful debate about religions without alienating somebody and without insulting somebody, therefore causing all sorts of shenanigans?
Well, I think what you're doing there is conflating two quite different things, which is insulting people and debating ideas. So I think a good rule of thumb in this area is that no person should be beneath respect, but no idea should be above criticism. Now, of course, I agree that we should not attack people, and especially we should not attack people because they're, say, religious minorities. And in order to protect people from those kind of attacks, we have the Incitement to Hatred Act in this country. So we're not proposing to change that act in any way. We're not proposing to remove any of the objections or protections to protecting people. What we're proposing to do is change the protection of ideas. So at the minute, what our blasphemy law does is it says there's lots of ideas in the country that you can criticise. You can criticise people's ideas about human rights or the free market or socialism. But blasphemy laws put a ring fence around religious ideas and say you're not allowed to criticise religious ideas. So, yeah, and I think the good rule of thumb is to say that no person should be beneath respect, but no idea should be above criticism.
The replacement of the word blasphemy and using sedition in there, would you just give me your explanation of that and why that is a better word? Because there's some similarities in wording, really.
Yes, the current article in the Constitution mentions three things. It mentions indecent material, it mentions blasphemous material, and it mentions seditious material. So out of that list of three, what we are proposing to do is just to remove one word, the single word of blasphemous, and then that will also allow the Dáil to repeal two other pieces of legislation. So one is the part of the Defamation Act that refers to blasphemy, and the second piece of legislation we'll repeal is one that a lot of people might not know we have. It's the Censorship Act. So we still have a banned books list here in Ireland, and a book can be banned because it's blasphemous. And what we'll be doing is to say we can no longer ban books for being blasphemous. I don't know, Fran, if you can think of any single person in Ireland who you would like to be your censor. Can you think of any single person who you would say, this person can decide for me what I can read and what I can't read? Because personally, I think I can decide for myself what I can read and what I can't read.
One of the points you're bringing up there, though, might make people a little bit fearful. I mean, here we are talking about the removal of the word blasphemy, but immediately you're saying that this gives jurisdiction then to politicians to change laws that we didn't agree to in the referendum.
No, it was the opposite. At the minute, politicians are required to infringe our human rights and infringe our freedom of expression. And so if politicians want to say that Irish people can decide for themselves what books they can read, they are prohibited from doing that because the Constitution forces them to make blasphemy a criminal offence. And what we're doing is giving politicians more freedom to say we don't have to do that because I don't think religious people in Ireland want that. I mean, the Roman Catholics that I know want to practice their own faith without imposing it on anyone else. I don't know any Roman Catholics who think Catholicism is about dragging non-Catholics in front of the courts to fine them €25,000 if they say anything that disagrees with Catholicism. I think Catholics are strong enough in their own faith that they can allow everyone to express a view and they can practice their own religion in their own way without enforcing it on everyone else.
And just a final word on this, John. I mean, the people who put together the Constitution, I presume, would have thought very carefully and heavily about this when they were putting this in. And they were smart people, you know. Is it a case that this is a different time, or how do you, were they wrong in the first place?
No, I think it's both. I think very smart people in different times had different ideas than we do today. And so, famously, Isaac Newton is often cited as one of the smartest people who ever lived, but he was an alchemist. He spent much of his life trying to turn iron into gold and trying to find codes in the Bible. So I think we just move on over time and our morality changes. So at the time when our Constitution was written, we thought morality involved discriminating against women, discriminating against gay people, shaming unmarried parents. All of those things were part of legislation when our Constitution was passed. But exactly as you say, time moves on. It doesn't mean the framers of the Constitution were stupid people. It just means that our morality and our ethics evolve over time, and we can do better now.
On behalf of both sides of this argument, my only concern is that there hasn't been enough discussion in the media about this, and in fact in Vox Pops that I've been listening to over the last while, there seems to be a lot of confusion. Does that worry you, John?
I suppose a little, yes. I think part of the reason for that is the coinciding with the presidential campaign. So I think Atheist Ireland has certainly been working very hard on a campaign around this blasphemy referendum. And exactly as you say, sometimes it's difficult because the messages get drowned out by the issues around the presidential election on the same day. But it's worth noting that it's not only Atheist Ireland campaigning for a yes vote. All the political parties are advocating a yes vote. The Catholic Church isn't opposing this. The Protestant churches aren't opposing this. And there is really a very broad consensus right across all of the civil society organizations that this really is an antiquated law that needs to go.
All right, John, good to talk to you today, and thank you for making time for us. That's John Hamill there, advocating a yes vote in the referendum on blasphemy, and John Hamill from Atheist Ireland.